Hello and Namaste. My name is Sumit Arora and I welcome you to this next session on School That Cares, where we interview educators. And today's educator is a person with 14 years of experience, a person who is the principal of Fort City School in Vijayanagaram in Andhra Pradesh, none other than Girija Rani Bandaru. Welcome, ma'am. Welcome to this session.
Hello, everyone. It's my great pleasure to be a part of this show. I'm looking forward to share my views and my experiences, which I have come through all these years. Thank you so much for inviting me on the show.
Thank you. Thank you for being here, ma'am. Yes, we are looking forward to your experiences, your learnings, so that all other educators, principals, other students and parents could learn from it. So let's begin with a small question, ma'am. Would love to understand, why did you come into the education field? What motivated you? Where are you basically from? So that then we could take this discussion further.
Yeah, to start with, it is all by the inspiration of my dad. Actually, my dad used to tell me that he overheard saying some of the parents' feelings, like he is a very poor man who is a rickshaw wala. He used to think that I have to give best education to my child. So that was my dad's, he overheard the conversation of those rickshaw walas, and he started an educational society, and we hosted a school at that time, which has got the minimal fee from class 1 to class 5. We will not be charging much fee. So that was an educational society started by my father, and from there the inspiration started. So I was part and parcel of this education system right from my childhood. So wow. I know all these things. The school which we have got is right from class 1 to a degree. So if a student enters into our campus with studying class 1, he'll be leaving after the completion of his degree. So that was my dad was a motivation behind this thought of being an educator, actually. So then when I am getting educated, I felt, what are the education qualifications I required to become an educator? That is how I proceeded with my education, and here I am today, successfully reached the goal which I have dreamed of in my childhood.
So you completed your Master of Arts, you did your BA, yeah. And all this through the young age when you were looking at your father developing this institution, which is for the, I may say, the marginalized, the poor and the needy, so that they learn and they improve. Awesome.
Yes, exactly. As you can see, being young, if I can say, I have got 14 years of experience. Right from the days I am doing my degree, I used to teach in the school. So that is how I started my career. So it went on like that. And that is the reason I could pursue the experience of 14 years, even being young. That is what I can proudly say about myself, because that is the only foundation which we have got. A good teacher only can become an educator, where we have passed through all the levels of education, where what happens in being a teacher, what happens being a coordinator, what happens being a vice principal. Then I have reached to the stage of principal.
That very, is very inspirational. Journey. Very, very inspirational. Not mandatory. That's something which we call as inspiration. Thank you. Thank you for saying that. It really is important learning for all educators and all aspiring people to look at how you grow the steps. It shouldn't be a parachute landing. You have to learn from the steps and be there. Awesome. One more important thing which comes in is when we are in schools, we do a lot of extracurricular activities. A lot of things are happening. Students are in there and everything is happening. March 2020 was the time when the first lockdown or COVID happened. What was the state of the school then? What was happening, and what really started with the announcement of the lockdown?
To be precise, at that moment, we were like, we finished all the syllabus, to be frank, and we are at the verge of conducting the examination, final examinations, where we have scheduled the examination dates, and we are looking forward. We just completed our annual day functions and all, and we are looking forward completely concentrated with the academics. So that was a break kind of thing, thinking that this was a lockdown. All of a sudden, that news has come out, and we were all like, we were waiting that we could conduct the examination. conversations after a small break or so. So that sure. Went on like that. It prolonged, and we couldn't conduct the final examinations of that academic session, to be frank. But I can say that was not that fruitfully bad, like, because the students have gone through the process of learning. Learning yeah. is not always attempting the examinations just to get the grades. Learning is something that we have to gain knowledge of that class. So as we have completed the syllabus, 2020 lockdown is a break for sure, but whereas only the assessment, final assessment is not being done, whereas the students have gone through the complete academic session, they had all the fun, they had completed all the activities, they had all the enjoyment. The only thing they missed is the final examinations. Sure. That was the status
that at was that one time. Of the slight thing, yeah. And very yes. rightly and truly said that assessment or examination is the end of the learning, if we may call it. If we are doing formative assessments, yes, we have already understood what the student knows or knows less, and the teachers have taken action. However, the final, which is the summative assessment, is only a report card away. Exactly. So how then the lockdown did not stop, and it continued until yes. the next year opened up. So what yes, challenges yes. did you face, or how did you overcome those challenges? What worked on the online mode and what didn't work? We'd love to hear more on that.
Yes, yes, definitely. I would love to share all those feelings, because it was a roller coaster ride, to be frank, at that moment. Sure. Because we were waiting, like, this month, the things will be fine and we are going to reopen. Whereas in schools, if we take, we are a very vast strength school. Like, we have got around 2,000 plus students in our school. It is a 4-section to 5-section school. Whereas we have wow. got all status students. Like, there are below BPL line students, and there are first generation students where they have got no equipment, like they haven't got gadgets, and every parent cannot provide a mobile phone, internet connectivity, the signal problems, all these things. And moreover, coming up with the faculty, they are not sure to get on to this online mode and talk like this, because everyone is not that expressive, and everyone will have their own boundaries and fears. They cannot express themselves as we all get onto the stage and talk. That's not everyone's cup of tea. So that was one another challenge we used to have. So first thing is, like, we need to train our teachers to get on to that stage of accepting to get on to the screen, whereas they have to come on to the screen where the cameras will be on, where the classes will be heard by n number of people who doesn't belong to their class at all. It is not just the student, the whole family is listening to their class. Sometimes dad or mom will get interrupt saying that, no, this is the something next level you have to teach to my kid, because they become overexcited. So all these things, the first challenge we have faced is like the connectivity, internet connectivity, no gadget availability with most of the students, whereas only 50% strength used to attend when we initially started. Like at that time, we started a month late, because to check out whether we can wait and start the schools physically. Then when we have got no hopes of starting the schools in a physical mode, then we took a step ahead, and first we initially sent some video recordings done by the teachers, whereas they have to get comfortable talking to the cameras instead of the students in the classroom. So first we recorded a small bits of classes, and first we sent them, and we asked the students to listen to those classes and attempt the worksheets initially. So that's how we brought them onto the track, first of all, through WhatsApp. We made class-wise WhatsApp groups. We sent a small video, listen to this video and solve the given worksheet. In such a way, we slowly started. And later, when it has come to the month of August, initially, we started online classes where the students can interact with each other. It is all live on online classrooms we have started. So that was a very great challenge, actually, because teachers are uncomfortable. The second thing is students, it is not in the reach of every student, because there are two children in a family. Whereas there is only one mobile phone available, there is no proper internet connectivity, and all such challenges we have faced. And the parents are, we even adjusted the slots. Like if the parents request us, they, we have got siblings. So we have made different slots. So we used to occupy the complete day, like two slots of one class where we have got more siblings matching. Like if sixth and eighth classes are having matched with more the siblings. These are all the problems we faced. And we tried to sort out in a way where parents also will not be burdened, because those were the tough times. Many people lost their jobs. They were out of income and they couldn't even invest money to get the gadgets at a time. So these were all the challenges we faced initially.
So if I just summarize these two, three points, which you very wonderfully said, was one challenge which the students and the families had was about the technology, about availability of gadgets, even the internet part of it. So that's one section where what can the school do? But you did not just stop there saying, what can I do about it? Families, it's your responsibility, do it. You cared for the families enough that you said, okay, if you even have one phone, we could have it shared between the two students. Just not about the phone, but also about the timings part of it. What do I do? You have two children. It's not my problem. You didn't say that. Wonderfully, you brought it out that yes, if you have one, if you have two children in the same slot, let me try and figure out how we could have multiple slots. Overburdening the teacher maybe in that due course, stretching them over a period of time, over a day.
Exactly. That's to equally. Be frank, at that moment, teachers are more stressed because they need to work for more hours.
Yeah,
because we already told the teachers that we need to take the pain where we need to keep the students in the mode of learning, where we should not let their minds pause without any learning. We have to interact them. They have to be active. Their mind should be precisely learning something. Yeah.
I also love your thought of creating videos and sending it on WhatsApp and asking students to do worksheets. A wonderful example of blended learning. Like they look at the videos, read them, understand them, and then go to the worksheet and solve it. That's also something great. Now, while doing all this, the teacher's mindset to change or to provide teachers with resources who are sitting at home, how easy was that? How did you really get through all of that? Because that could also have been a challenge.
Yes, yes, definitely. Because teachers are also out of gadgets, to be frank. They have got no proper internet connectivity. And we cannot insist them, asking them to come to the schools. We will be providing you the gadgets. So that is also an issue. For a few of the teachers, we tried to give some gadgets from school and or supply a PC or a computer to their home where they need to work on it if the teacher is unable to handle it on their own. So to be frank, I have got a very cooperative team, that my team of teachers came out saying that no, madam, we are going to purchase ourselves, and they came out, and most of the team has got the equipment, but we haven't taught through laptops. Most of the teachers taught through mobiles only, but they learned the skill of sharing the screens, sharing the YouTube videos in the live classes. So all sorts of these kind of trainings we have given. Most of the times it was a very tough task to the teachers. They used to feel like it was a war field every day. Once they get onto the class, initially when we started online classes, there is no discipline among the students. And the second thing is, like, parents are overexcited to listen to the teacher talking to their kid. If the teacher need to warn a student saying that you are not listening to the class properly, that used to offend the parent also. Are Baba, why you are telling my child so harsh? Teacher is so rude at my child. Why can't the teacher so soft to my child? So these are the initial practical issues, to be frank, the teachers faced, because they need to be very cautious with the preparation first thing, and they need to get all the screen sharings, all the videos they need to share, and sometimes they have to get some extra resources to show it in the class, like the flashcards, all such things. They need to prepare all this. Along with this, they need to take the stress of the parents, because sometimes parents interrupt in the middle of the classes saying that, madam, my child, you are not asking much questions. My child is always mute. He's not listening to the class, because all the complaints used to happen in the classes itself. Earlier, we used to have parent-teacher meetings only at the time of the assessments or so. like once in a fortnight
month
or like
quarter,
a
yeah.
yeah month or quarterly or months in a 6 months or so. But now every day, every hour is a parent teacher meeting. Like yeah. anytime the parent will interrupt and he will say, "See, my child haven't done homework, madam. You should do something immediately." So these are the challenges we faced initially. But
I love this information. Like a teacher who was earlier the king of her classroom or the queen of her classroom. Now she was exposed to the entire world. Now the students were equally equipped. I have seen a lot of videos where we've seen students taking control of the class, putting something on the, disturbing the class, singing something, putting it across. And the teacher who is not fully equipped with the audio video controls of the class as of now was struggling with it. And the second important part where the parent comes in and says, okay, this is not the right way, or this is not what is happening, and this is what I want. So that's something very typical to learn. And I would love to call these teachers as front-end warriors, whether anybody agrees or doesn't agree, because they have been in the front end to teach students, to give them the learning experience, even during the COVID times. That has been the real thing which you, school principal and team together has done. I need to understand, were there a few new practices which you evolved, a few new processes, or a few new teaching learning methods which you evolved during these days?
The syllabus pattern we used to send, along with the timetable and the syllabus, I asked my teachers to prepare PPTs on every lesson as a summarized part of the lesson, because we are not giving a default video which is available in the YouTube. In our school, our teachers only will make the customized lesson-wise videos to our students. So our teachers took the pain of doing that, and they have made beautiful videos of every subject, like including Telugu, Hindi, and the Telugu is our vernacular language over here. Yeah. And Telugu to every subject, they made beautiful videos on each and every lesson. That video will summarize, like we usually take 3 to 4 days to complete one lesson in full, like the grammar part or whatever, the vocabulary, all the things, all the parts of the lesson. So all these 3 to 4 days of the part of the lesson is being concluded within a video of 30 to 40 minutes, which is being done by our teachers with a PPT presentation. Slide-wise. So the PPT presentation will have a small camera pop-up where the teacher face will be visible, explaining the concept. And we have uploaded it in our YouTube channel, which Fort City School has got a YouTube channel, which we started just to overcome the hurdles which we faced during this COVID times, to stay connected with our students. And we used to send it along with the revision formats. So at the revision time, if the student want to go through the topic once again, he can just click the link and go to the explanation and listen to the lesson once again, and he can revise, whereas the teacher only will be teaching one-on-one. So that is one innovative thought we have made, whereas we made our own customized video lessons done by our teachers with the help of the PPTs. And the second thing, second innovative thought we have come across using the same YouTube platform is, like, we have marked every curricular and co-curricular activities, including the extracurricular activities like Teacher's Day, Children's Day, all these activities we have marked online.
Wow.
So a week before, we used to send, because we have got not that equipped platform over here where I can run things online. If it is a very equipped area, this is like a place where we will not have proper connectivity issues are more in this area.
Agreed.
So what we have done is, I used to give the concepts class wise, this class to this class, this is your concept, record a 1 minute video and send it to us. That was a competition we have conducted, and best of the videos will be picked, and we made it into a program, like Children's Day program. It is if it is fancy dress competition, there are beautiful fancy dress competition outfits the students have worn, and the parents, literally to say, they have cooperated a lot, because when their children are performing and they could see in a social media platform like YouTube, they also felt happy. Initially they were like, the inputs of the parents or the entries for this kind of thing were very less. When we hosted one program in the YouTube, parents were so impressed, and we have got great response from the parents sending that they used to say, 1 minute video recordings, and we used to pick the best video recordings, including recently the World Environment Day also has been marked, And we have published that video also in our YouTube channel, where we show this talent of our students. Class wise, we used to give some concepts. Wonderful. These are the two initial things we have taken, and they were great success.
This is something very good to hear, that we have our own YouTube channel where we have our teachers' videos as a revision part of it. Normally, where revision is something which we do in the classroom after a few sessions, and now students can choose their own revision time. They could go to offline, they could go there, and they don't have to be in synchronous with the classroom, and they can just go and revise themselves. And putting in students' videos of 1 minute on various extracurricular things is something which comes in great. One important question which I have is, during the classrooms, we used to have a lot of interaction between the students and a lot of cohesion, lot of energy exchange, emotional connections between students, teachers, everything. It was fun. It's friends. Now, students must have lost that connection in the virtual world, or have you done something even on those lines to help students build their community or connection or something on those things?
Yeah, to address such kind of issues, we have conducted some debates online, where we have picked the students, and a group of students will be discussing on one topic, and they will shoot a question to the other topic, where the online interactions go on by switching on the cameras as we are talking in a virtual mode like this. True. So the same way, we encouraged our students also to get on to the mode of virtual mode, and where they had the discussions of debates, and we even conducted quiz competitions. And there was a short break the corona have taken from first wave to second wave. At that moment also, we have initially invited some of the students who are being selected for these quiz competitions, and 4 or 5 students in a group, we have conducted the math day, math quiz competitions, and small mini science fair kind of thing. All such things are being hosted even at the COVID times last year. It was not in a grand scale we used to do, but we did in a small mini sort of scale, where less number of students will be included, and we maintained that social distancing thing, and we hosted few things, and we also has given this art integrated project, which is a part of CBSE, which has been initiated last year, even from from the first class. Our grade 1 students have come up with the topic called professions. They all dress up in different professions, and we have conducted a one-on-one interview kind of session in the school, whereas they come and they talk about their profession with all the equipment. They put on the costume and they show what is the prominence of the profession, what they do, all such things we have exposed. This thing we have done class wise, because as I told you, we have got 3 to 4 sections. When we mix up all the sections, only few students will be getting exposed to the platforms. So I want each and every child to come out and speak. So unless we express ourselves fluently, that is what the real learning is. If you have got the grades and if you have got the certificates or the master degrees, that will not make you as a person. What you can express, what you can talk in public is what it is you being reflected over there. So I suggest my students to come out, express yourself. What is running your mind, you must be able to express it in the words. Then only you are learning something, you are really got the concept or something.
Very, very so true, ma'am. Like every student should speak up or should get an opportunity to perform. No student should be left behind. These are certain phrases which I've always heard, but seeing you in action doing this and ensuring that every classroom gets an independent time slot where they do these activities. Otherwise, only the top performers are there on the stage. Others are just clapping around and doing nothing. So that's something which really energizes me to hear that you are doing so wonderful things, that caring for each student is there. Now, as the days have passed from 2020 with new practices coming in, 2021 has come in. Did assessment happen this year, finally online, or 2021 also went without an assessment or something?
2021, actually, we have conducted 2 sessions of offline sessions. Mm-hmm. And 2 sessions of online sessions. And one more innovative thing I have done is the sessions what I have conducted online also, we asked the students to put up a separate notebook for the assessments. So that is an assessment book. Whereas after the assessment examination, which has been written at home, I have no problem however they are writing, but that has to be submitted to the school after the examination. Because teacher is going to evaluate it. When you have a concern of submitting it somewhere, at least you will attempt it. So in such a way, that was a successful assessment, I can say that successfully, and we are happy with that also.
I'm very happy to hear the word we have to change and adapt as per times. And this is something which corporates always talk about, hearing it from a principal, hearing it from the education world, where we say it's just not about the tradition of doing the same things the same way. But if it is a new way, if it's a new world, it has to be something which we do newly. Now,
yes,
ma'am, we heard from you about YouTube channels, videos, how assessment is done differently. And now with this passing of COVID, maybe hopefully when the schools restart and things are back to normal, what are those practices and innovations which you would love to continue in spite of if even the school, full school goes fully on?
Some things like the interaction of the students that we have to increase if the school comes on to the physical mode, as we have conducted online the class-wise assessments or the class-wise activities. I would like to continue that even coming on to the offline sessions. Whereas when we conduct such activities, we gather a few classes where we select a few number of students and they come up with their talents showing it. So instead of that, I'm looking forward to give opportunity for each and every child. The child who is sitting at the last bench corner has also to be elevated, and he also has got some talent. Every child is unique and he has got some talent. As we all are talking about competitive education, now it is turning to be the competency kind of education. Whereas if you are learning a task in 10 days, that is good. If I'm learning it in 20 days, that is also fine. But learning the concept in full mode is more important than having a time limit. So this kind of innovative thoughts, I'm looking forward for my students to let every child come forward, take the stage, hold the mic and talk confidently with proper body language, expressing himself. That is the only target we need to achieve before he leave our school.
Wonderful. So from competition to competent student. That's something which is really wonderful to hear from you, ma'am. With towards coming towards the end of the session, Girija, ma'am, would you like to address the educators who would be watching this video, or even the parents who would be wanting to hear from you about their roles and responsibilities in the child's learning and development?
Definitely. First of all, to the educators, I heard, like, I have got friends from the same field, whereas they were so perplexed with the things when the situations are wrong, but they used to have an assumption that only the traditional way of teaching will make the students to learn. Other than that, there is no other way to teach. Nothing like that. There is a way where the students, as of now, if you can say, this online world is making education much better and easier. The only way is we have to use it more. It is reachable anywhere. If a child has to join in my school, he doesn't need to be here in Vijayanagaram. He can join from anywhere in the world, to be frank. The same quality of education, I can give it to any child in the world if you would like to join. So that is one plus, because from here a child can even join a school in Canada, or he can get through any course, go through that, those things. That is one window which has been opened through this online education, and the information which is available online is very vast. So educators always get to know about the new things, always keep adopting the new practices, keep tuning with the new strategies, and always remember that there is a way out of every hurdle. So if we are coming out very effectively and productive, we are making it in a good note. So my suggestion is, like, we always think forward to come out with a better opportunity where the child gets enhanced with his skills, where he can learn the new concept, where he can improve his inquired-based teaching, that creativity that has to be ignited. And coming up with the parents and the students, don't restrict your child much. It is not that you have to hold him and tell that, see, this is your classroom. You have to hold the books from so-and-so time to so-and-so time. When you give a restriction, the child will not feel that freeness in his mind. So let his thoughts wander wherever he wants, but guide them in the right direction. Listen to his concerns, let him ask his questions, though they are not very concerned questions. Even a silly question will make a big concept. So let the questions be asked by the students, let their curiosity stay there, their excitement has to be addressed. We have to take it in a positive way. So I request the parents are also much involved with the students now a time, because my child performance has to be enhanced in the classroom. So they are also helping out. Do not help out while they are doing, just guide them, be there, but do not tell what to do, how to do, let them do, because everyone will have a style of doing. They have to do it in their own style, because your child will have a style. Let them pursue his style, let them recognize his style and do it in his own way. So I want parents to leave that free hand to the students, and as well be there as a guider, be there as a mentor, guide them in a proper way. If they are going in a wrong way, then please guide them, but do not tell, do not hold their hand and make them to do something. Let them do in their own style.
Very, very true. How wonderfully do you explain to the parents about not being very critical with their children, not being very kind of micromanaging them, of holding the book this way or sitting for so many hours, and in fact giving them a freedom of choice of choosing this time or that time or this way or that way, and supporting them in their cause or in their ownership of learning? This is so wonderful. Exactly.
Internet, like in the Google, if you can type. Yes, fortcityschool.com. You can go to our site, whereas you can contact us through the inquiry, which we have got the admission inquiry over there, and you can reach us if you would like to take admissions in our school.
Thank you, ma'am. So with a dedicated team, with infrastructure and the vision of getting every student the experience which will make him a leader, here we have with us a lady who has 14 years of experience plus the wisdom of looking 14 years beyond, not something that what I have learned and I'll keep doing the same thing. A person who told us how she cared for the parents, what the school did for the students, or even the teaching staff who were there, and now waiting with open mind for the new year to begin with opening the real school in the real classrooms. We have with us Girija Rani Bandaru to thank for her contribution to the school that cares, and for her sharing of wisdom, because she cares for the educators and the parents and the students. Thank you, ma'am. It was wonderful speaking to you.
Thank you so much. It's great, great pleasure for me also to share all my thoughts and interacting with you. Thank you so much. Thank you.